Here we are again. Those of you who were at the Virtual Library Legacy events yesterday, the second half of this year's BeLgo Lab event, we had some really quite fruitful discussion, I think, yesterday on a practical level of some literary translations and translatability. From Dutch and French texts into English. We'll be looking at other approaches to translation this morning with, I hesitate to say more traditional academic papers, but I think everybody knows what I mean. Very pleased to introduce Irving Wolters, who's working on a PhD at UCL on the Biblioteca de Atlantica and its publishing policies and so on. You may want to introduce things a little more fully, and let's move into the first paper of the day then. I think this means your lights, camera, and if you will, action.
Okay. Right, morning everybody. Thank you. So, I'm going to tell you a story about an organisation that translated languages. I'm going to concentrate on a series of volumes that it translated, and then I'm going to hone in on one of the five Flemish volumes in the series and discuss the translator's choices and problems that he encountered. So the title of my piece is Translator's Choices in the Literary Field, Alex Brotherton's translation of Gerard Walschap's Marriage, Ordeal, Trouwen, Celibaat. The foundation. The foundation for the promotion of the translation of Dutch literary works was a state-funded, quasi-governmental organisation set up to deal with assisting the translation of over 700 Dutch and Flemish literary works into a variety of languages until 1989. It was established in 1954 under the initiative of the Secretary General of the Ministry of Education, Arts and Sciences, in cooperation with a number of agencies, including the Pen Nederland, the Dutch Literary Society, the Flemish Literature Association. This was done for reasons of cultural diplomacy, and specifically then, in my opinion, for reasons of colonialism. The functions of the foundation were administered by a commissioning body who acknowledged that the language barrier was a factor in their literature not being read abroad, but recognised that Dutch science had succeeded in crossing linguistic frontiers, and that, moreover, the literatures of other small countries enjoyed greater notoriety than Dutch letters. In addition, there were a great many works which were of interest to the reader outside the Netherlands because they shed light upon an aspect of European life which, for most people, had so far remained obscure. They highlighted the fact that there is no point speculating about the reasons for this obscurity. It is better to examine whether and how this situation may be changed. This is precisely the aim which the Foundation is setting itself. It wants to do everything in its power to enable the foreign reader, and thus first and foremost the publisher, to acquaint himself with Dutch literature. One of the commissioning body's initial tasks was to administer the translation of a series of Dutch and Flemish literature into English called the Bibliotheca Neerlandica. And on the 3rd of January 1955, the initial commissioning body's meeting took place in Leiden with a goal to A, establish contacts between Dutch and foreign publishers, and B, to increase awareness of Dutch literature abroad. This was the series that was eventually published, although it was larger than this. There were 17. And I will come to that and explain it later. Minder, the chairman of the commissioning body, played a great role in initiating the Bibliotheca Neerlandica, desiring a classical series geared towards Flemish literature. His doctorate in 1947 concerned the Flemish poet Karel van der Woestijn, and although born in Amsterdam, he favoured Flemish literature, having written before the Second World War for the Flemish literary magazine Hekuta, and later in Der Spiegel der Lettre as a member of the editorial staff. The responsibilities of the commissioning body involved discussions of texts to be translated, but I have formed an impression that Mindera coerced the members of the commissioning body into accepting his personal choices for works. The decisions for the selection of works in the volumes were based almost exclusively on committee members' personal literary interests, which then came to form an emerging literary canon in the Netherlands without consideration of the individual work's potential relevance for a wider readership. Mindera had based his ideas for the Bibliotheca Neerlandica on a previously published series called Bibliotheca Flandrica, originally named the Bibliotheca Belgica, published in German by Diederich Verlag Düsseldorf between 1950 and 54. The foundation used this Flemish series as a model, which was unfortunate since only six of the volumes from a Plan 25 were published because it had met with publishing and translation issues that would similarly affect the Bibliotheca Neerlandica. In the minutes of the commissioning body on the 28th of November 1958, it was noted that even the Flemish Academy did not put much value on the Bibliotheca Flandrica series, and adds that the six works were poorly received, mainly due to the quality of the translations. Between 1955 and 61, when Mindera resigned as chairman, countless works were considered for the Bibliotheca Neerlandica, which resulted in a proposed 17 volumes, of which only 10 were realised. They were published between 1963 and 69 by the Dutch publishing company Zeithof in conjunction with Heinemann. Many issues were discussed during this period, but I found this interesting. During the meeting of the commissioning body held in Brussels on the 27th of November 64, I highlight this from the minutes. Mr. Stateman read letters from the Belgian minister Fayet and Dr. Kuipers, representing the Flemish Academy, in which he sharply condemned the use of the words Flemish, Flanders and Fleming on the back flaps of the seven published Bibliotheca Neerlandica volumes. The publishers had been contacted, and while Zeithof didn't mind making the alterations, Birch from Heinemann did, as the covers had already been printed. Walschap, who was a member of the commissioning body then, said it was too rigorous, while Professor Brand Courtius felt that the publishers had done everything to emphasize the unity of Netherlands literature, and that this issue concerned the English language and not the Dutch. In effect, the following happened. It's this that you need to read. It's not very good, but it's a library of classics of Dutch and Flemish literature from the back flap of the first seven volumes was altered to a library of Dutch classics from Holland and Belgium for the following three. They were L. Schott's three novels, Multatuli's Max Havelaar, and Reinhard the Fox, and other medieval Netherlands secular literature. The text under this, containing the words Flemings and Flemish, however, remained the same. Obtaining translators for the works proved to be a formidable problem. Because these languages are seldom taught abroad, dominated languages, to more than an interested few, and able translators in these languages are consequently limited in supply. Heilbronn emphasised that the poor quality of translators at the time was because the profession of a translator held no recognised status, since it was just a hobby or a provider of supplementary income for academics who lived abroad or knew a second language. Candidates with a literary background were examined to test their translation skills, but no more than 10% of applicants were suited to this specialised, difficult task. And it became evident that finding good translators was a really difficult problem. In Italian, for example, many books were translated via an intermediary language because there are insufficient people with the literary expertise to directly translate from Italian into Dutch, into Italian from Dutch. This was the case even with French. The translators were also very poorly paid. Overstegen, the director of the foundation, stated that soon after his appointment, he started to search for translators, but was conscious of the fact that the foundation could not compete with the higher translation salaries in the industry. He stated in an activity report that a translated biscuit factory advertisement earned up to three times more than a translated long essay by Vestdijk. Three Flemish authors were chosen for the series: Tiering's The Man in the Mirror, Het Galgenmaal, L. Schott's three novels, Sofso, Lyman, The Leg, Bang, and Will of the Wisp, Het Twaalicht, and Walschap's Trouwen and Celibaat, which appeared together as Marriage, Ordeal. So these are the three that we used. I put next to it the original painting that was used for it, because in my PhD I'm also looking at book design and cover design and so on. So this was intrigued by Ensor. This is The Muscle Eaters by Christophe de Smet, which was used. You'll note that the original paintings are very beautiful and they become transposed to black and white. Having said that, and I've done quite a bit of work on this, this is the one that we're going to look at. This is The Lovers by Christophe de Smet, the Verliefden. Although this painting is now with Christophe de Smet's son in Belgium, and they prefer the title de Minnaars, which also means being in love, but it has a connotation of not being in love, but the lovers of having more an affair. I have done quite a bit on this, and of work, and this transposition of certainly beautiful colour paintings to black and white. At the same time, the foundation were dealing with another series for the French market, and one of the works they chose was Celibat, not the other one, which has just gone through for the one. But they've done Celibat, Trouwen, and the French's solution was this. So that's Celibat, that's just a black circle with a red circle. So all this enormous work that they've gone into here to find these lovely manuscripts and paintings and things, and here they just didn't, the French just didn't bother. So Alex Brotherton was commissioned by the Zytel Publishing Company in the 60s to translate three novels for the Bibliotheca in Illandica, which included two of the three Flemish titles, L. Schott's three novels and Walschap's Marriage Ordeal. He was a multilingualist, fluent in Javanese and Malay, and well-versed in Chinese and Turkish, Bahasa and Indonesian, Russian, Italian, French and Dutch, and had a degree in comparative linguistics. So he wasn't a fool. He was resident in Holland for many years with his partner until his death. He was the only translator chosen by Zeithoff to translate three works for them in the series, and his ability was shown in 1967 when he won the Martinus Nyhoff Prize for Translations. In his vote of thanks, Brotherton pointed out difficulties of words such as Gesellschaft and Benedend Moordijk, which are difficult to translate into English, and stressed that it was important to preserve the stylistic characteristics of the original text in a literary text, advocating breaking new boundaries and ignoring rules that should not be broken. His partner, Hetty Verhuijst, in Amsterdam, who's still alive, whom I met, told me that he often felt alone in the literary field, since he had no published academic resources to draw from and had to make up the rules as he went along. Translation studies didn't exist at the time, and Brotherton had to develop his own strategy without recourse to established academic literature in dealing with issues that arose. And I'm going to use Marriage Ordeal as my case study for this. In the 1960s, only two short stories by Walschap, Cure Through Aspirin and The Fox, The Little Fox, existed in English. Both novels penetrate the substance of family life to its deepest levels. Rick, the hero of Marriage, is a spoiled egocentric whose existence, almost despite himself, is given genuine meaning and worth by his wife, a woman of determined but kind ambition. In Ordeal, the protagonist Andre is an apparent semi-imbecile whose life of frustrated incompetence is enlightened and ennobled by suffering and hideous disfigurement. Four key areas may well have caused Brotherton concern, which included foreign words within a text, which we looked at yesterday, translating titles, translating proper names and fidelity, and I'm going to highlight these. I'd like to draw particular attention to Celibaat, written in 1934, where Walschap wrote sentences and paragraphs of the Flemish work in German and French. I was interested in his linguistic ability in these languages to ascertain if the source text was correct, and inquired at the Walschap Society in Antwerp. His daughter Carla confirmed to me that he did indeed speak French, German, English and Spanish. The issue here concerns how Brotherton dealt with the problem of all these languages directed at an English target audience of the 60s when these novels were translated. Lefebvre acknowledges the translational problems of foreign words and text. He agrees that the writer put them there for a reason, and that to translate them as if they were not foreign words may be to detract from the complexity of the original. His solution is to leave the foreign word untranslated, and then to append a translation between brackets, or even to insert a translation into the body of the text. Rice, however, states that explanatory translations which help the reader in the target language by keeping the foreign term but with a brief appositional supplement are useful, since footnotes are a nuisance, breaking the flow of reading and marring the effectiveness of the text in the target language. Landers, however, is not in favour of footnotes, as they destroy the mimetic effect, the attempt by fiction writers to create the illusion that the reader is actually witnessing, if not experiencing, the events being described. Brotherton chose to offer no assistance to the reader in the form of explanations or footnotes, and remain true to the source text. There are, I think, occasions when Brotherton could have chosen to offer explanations to aid non-French speaking readers, which could have been integrated into the text. The Flemish population in the 30s would have had few, when the book was written, would have had few issues with the French text, and with Germany lying close by on the border, would have had a constant exposure to that language as well. This was, however, not the case for the largely monolingual English-speaking target audience of the time. Lefebvre makes the point that foreign words can be used to add colour to the text, but the issue with Ordeal is that there is foreign text in many languages. I believe that Brotherton possessed an understanding of the culture, and indeed, Ina Rilke, a work colleague of Brotherton's at the time, stated that he was a believer in the domesticating or target-oriented approach of translation remaining too true to Walschap's original. The question here relates to what exactly Brotherton's translation approach to the issue was. Was he trying to create a sense of foreignness to the reader at the loss of understanding, offering a lifeline in the form of footnotes, or even translating the sentences and preceding them with speaking in French and German would have helped the reader and allowed the feeling of foreignness to still exist? His translation strategy was successful in remaining faithful to the original, in allowing the reader to discover the answers himself, even though the English-speaking audience of the 60s would not have been as multilingual as Walschap's. A second translation issue for Brotherton involved the choice of titles for the novel. Regarding this, Landers states, a serviceable title has even greater importance for translations than for English-speaking originals, given Anglo-Saxon reluctance to read foreign works, translations need all the help they can get. Overstaken, the director of the commissioning body, cited Lehman from the London magazine as having said, "De Engelse interessieren zich niet voor hun eigen literatuur, laat staan van die van andere naties." The English aren't interested in their own literature, let alone that of others. The two novels, Trouwen and Celibaat, although originally written and published separately by Walschap, are placed together in one volume. The titles of Trouwen and Celibaat have been translated as Marriage or Deal, and each one of these two titles has been dealt with in a different manner. I'd like to consider the choices that Brotherton had in his selection of titles. Trouwen, meaning marriage, was translated as marriage, but Celibaat, meaning celibacy, was changed to ordeal, probably because the latter captured the negative contemporary connotations surrounding the celibate state relating to scandals concerning Catholic priests in the 60s. This, however, resulted in the harmony of the two titles, marriage and celibacy, being lost. It's likely that Brotherton was under immense pressure from the publisher to finish the work early, and as Molly Meyer, a work colleague of his at the time, states, as far as the time he was given, I can't help you, but publishers are often in a hurry, and moreover, he was at one time dependent on this work, which was no gold mine. Brotherton was thus faced with a variety of choices in dealing with the title, and may then have chosen to exchange a then controversial title for a more socially acceptable one. The issue of a harmony between the two titles of Trouwen and Celibaat being lost was not, in my opinion, Brotherton's fault. Walschap wrote both novels separately and 3 years apart, and I don't feel that he wrote them as a delayed pair. It may also not have been known to Brotherton that the two translated novels would appear together in one volume. In the French, for example, only one was used separately. A third demanding strategy issue for Brotherton in Celibaat was his translation of Het Hierken, a Flemish expression meaning a precocious, naughty little boy, as the little lordy. Het Hierken could not be left in the original, as it would be meaningless to an English speaker. The problem is that the translated little lordy means little in English and is confusing to an English reader. I've never come across it anywhere and have no idea where Brotherton obtained it. he could have simply replaced his Hirken with something along the lines of the young gentleman, which suffers a loss in foreignization and moreover its feature of an aloof young man, or even little Lord Fauntleroy, which was available to him at the time. A fourth issue for Brotherton concerned grammar errors. They had dug into the problem, discovered that they had, all three of them, noticed it already. The oftener, the better. And this is a real humdinger. And when the major got to telling about the time when, as a boy of six, he had given an angry rooster that had chased him right into this room a blow with a stick and killed it, and nom de tonnerre, didn't I get a thrashing for it, and I still don't know how I did it, and then they waited patiently and then until they could make themselves heard again. That does need a bit of reworking. The issue with many of these errors is that they could not have been all attributed to Brotherton, who was a native speaker, and it appears that poor copy editing played its part. Coley points out that proofreaders were non-English at the time. She states that there are many typographical errors because the typesetters are Dutch, and proofreaders are everywhere, scarce, I suppose, which can be cleaned up in further printings, except that only a couple of the volumes were further printed. They lacked an eye for detail, and as a player in the literary field, were influential in the mistakes found in the published work. James Holmes wrote in an English language review of Dutch language writing in the 60s, "The copy editor should be a native speaker of English who is well versed in Dutch and Flemish culture, and in Dutch literature, and is an excellent stylist in English. He, she will not be easy to find." Molly Meyer agrees that publishers are often in a hurry, and this may have been a contributory factor in Brotherton's occasional use of poor style, since he was a man of experience, but may have been under pressure to finish the translation quickly. In conclusion then, Alex Brotherton had to constantly make choices while translating, and I needed to establish how competent he was as a translator to make informed choices. He was fluent or well-versed in many languages, had a degree in comparative linguistics, teaching at the Department of Linguistics in Amsterdam for many years. He had translated other volumes for the series and won literary prizes. The issue was that in the 60s, when Brotherton translated the work, translation studies as an academic study subject did not exist, and he therefore had to recognize, had no recourse to publish literature on the subject. He was consequently forced to become a pioneer and make his own choices. When dealing with foreign words within a text, Brotherton did not translate the French, German and Latin sections of Celibaat. For the time, perhaps this was the correct strategy, since those with a grammar school education would have had exposure to French and German, and perhaps some Latin. The foreign language sections are not critical in understanding the storyline, but add foreignization to the text, allowing interested parties to discover the meanings of these sections themselves if they so wish. He also chose not to offer explanations, footnotes, or annotations for the same reason. When dealing with titles, Brotherton chose Ordeal, most likely to opt out of controversy. There was an absence of technology in the 60s, notably of computers, which could have performed spell checking, made grammar corrections. This was left to the translator and copy editor, and the published copy of Marriage Ordeal had many typographical and grammatical errors. Reviews also form a part of the literary field, and I located two which were favourable to Brotherton and may have helped on a modest scale to increase awareness of the translated work. Shrapnel of the Manchester Guardian in 64 favourably reviewed Marriage Ordeal, concluding that There's a rich humanity about this writing that might well provide our own fiction with a blood transfusion we could well use. Coley in 67 reviewed all of the Bibliotheca Neerlandica series published at the time and discussed the psychological sufferings in Marriage Ordeal, as well as the fact that she found Brotherton's work to be natural and graceful. On October the 25th, 1966, Heinemann's representative Birch wrote to his colleague Flinus at Zeithof, indicating a desire to terminate the Bibliotheca Neerlandica contract following publication of the 10th volume. He wrote, "Soon we will be publishing Max Havelaar by Montatuli and medieval Netherlands secular literature. After this, we're left with the unwritten history of Dutch literature and several volumes of essays and poetry. As you will see, the sales for the more recent volumes have declined. If we deduct the copies sold to the Dutch and Belgian governments, then they have been small throughout. Our editorial costs have been rising constantly. It was originally agreed that the Stichting, the foundation, would commission the translations and forward the final version to us complete. Many of the translations have been in poor English and have required a great deal of rewriting. They have turned a marginally profitable series into an unprofitable venture. 1,000 of each of the printed works, 3,000 copies, were bought by the Dutch and Belgian governments and given to libraries and institutions around the world, with Heinemann, the English publisher, its remaining stock to the foundation at a considerable reduction. The foundation sought, in my opinion, literary capital by exporting its literature through cultural diplomacy, but this was artificially engineered by governmental intervention and book buying. Marriage Ordeal is now out of print, but it did become one of Bibliotheca Neerlandica's best sellers. Unlike some of its sister works, it hasn't appeared in any other series, nor been updated in translation. Celibaat did, however, appear, as I said to you before, in a French version. If you wish to know what happened to the 10 published volumes, or indeed the 7 unpublished ones, including 4 17th century Dutch works, Van der Lucifer, Hoos Granida, Breda Roos, the Spanish Brabanta, and Herkens Trouwen Cornelis, the 3 anthologies of poetry, essay and short stories, the Flemish writers' volumes of Steinstrovels, Het Leven in de Dood, in de Aast, Life and Death, which is a poor translation, which were to have appeared in one volume, as well as the Short History of Dutch and Flemish Literature by Meyer, which became a seminal work in Dutch university departments, although not published by the foundation. If you want to know what happened to all these things, ladies and gentlemen, then you'll have to read my PhD. Thank you very much. If I could just take 1 minute, just this, so just that you know what it is. The top number 1 is my email address. 2, there is a review here of, it wasn't an academic paper, but it was my first claim to fame, in that I had dealings when I did my master's with the Gerard Walschap Society, and they were very kindly nice to me, and they were interested in what I did, and wrote a review of my PhD in their newsletter. But they also requested a copy of my dissertation, which is in the University Library at Antwerp, which I was pleased about. Secondly, at the back there is an English review of this, which only happened in January this year, went on the internet of that work. And finally, I did a lot of work last year for a chapter of a volume which isn't about Walschap, but it is about my PhD, about the Bibliotheca Neerlandica and the foundation. And that is a chapter, 7,000 words, and should appear later this year in a published volume on small nations' literatures. Thank you.